Well, my name is Maria Blanco. I'm a professor at the Technical University of Madrid, and well, I've been working with Capri for now some, yeah, quite a lot, or quite a few years, really. So I'm going to provide a presentation on the supply module. So this will be, I mean, really an overview of the supply module, and I think later in the morning or later today you are going to go into the details of some of the parts that I'm going to present here. So let's start with the approach. We'll start with presenting the approach chosen in Capri, and then I mean we'll look at the structure of the supply module, and we will also provide some hints on the technical implementation, meaning on the how this is implemented in the code of Capri. So meaning we'll look a bit at the GAMS code, but I mean really it's just some hints on that. So if we start then with the approach that we choose in Capri, yeah, to model a supply, well, most probably, I mean, you remember you have seen yesterday, or maybe, I mean, when looking at the tutorial at the materials for this training, that in Capri we have a different approach for the European regions and the rest of the world, meaning since we are going to focus at the supply module, please remember, please know that this supply module is built for representing agricultural production in Europe, yeah, in the European Union and other well candidate countries. So and meaning that the approach, yeah, for the global market model in Capri is different. So we'll focus at the supply module here, meaning for EU regions. Well, I mean, if we look at the if we think about the approaches that we can use, we could distinguish mainly two different approaches, and you have then there in the slides on the left side you have this mathematical programming approach, and on the right side of the slide the system of equations. Well, the both approaches have pros and cons. For instance, as pros, the system of equations can use econometric techniques, and the specification is based on observed data. But on the other hand, the choice of the functional form for the supply functions is restricted. So we don't have a lot of flexibility there, and maybe more importantly for us, resource constraints such as the land constraint cannot be easily incorporated in the model. Yeah, and the same for other technological or policy constraints. This, if we look at the system of equation, if we choose an optimization approach, then in this case, the resource constraints can be easily integrated in the model, and also technological or policy constraints can be modeled explicitly. So these are clear advantages, I mean, of this mathematical programming approach. However, in this case, the calibration of the model is not straightforward, and well, the model can yield corner solutions, and that can be far from observed data. So in Capri, what we do is we choose this optimization approach because I mean, we consider that it's important to be able to represent in our model technological constraints and also policy constraints. I mean, if we look at the common agricultural policy, there's a lot of details, and this approach provides much more flexibility to incorporate all those details. But I mean, if we choose this optimization approach, I mean, we need to overcome this drawback about how to calibrate to observe data or to observe projections. And to do this, what we do is to use a positive mathematical programming, that is a method to calibrate optimization models that is now very widely used because I mean what we do, I mean, is to integrate in the model observed behavior using some econometrics. So it's a way to, I mean, to calibrate our model and to be sure that we can reproduce observed data and given projections. So in this way, we can calibrate our model and we can model agricultural policies and technological constraints at great detail. And this means that this is the approach that we have chosen in Capri for these supply models. I mean, you are going to have all the details on this calibration method later on, so I'm not going to focus on that. So for now, I mean, we are going to see an overview of the supply module, and what we need to remember is that this supply module means optimization models under constraints. So, as you probably remember, the Capri supply model represents supply for each NAT2 region in the European Union, including also Norway, the Balkan countries, Turkey, and some others. And this means that we are going to build a mathematical programming model for each of those regions. Meaning that those models are independent. We have one model for each region. They are created as template models, meaning all models have the same structure, with different data for each regions. Those models maximize profit of the region under constraints, and all those models also are just supply models, and they assume that prices are exogenous. Then, to obtain the supply for the whole European Union, the results for each of those models need to be summed up. And in this way, we are going to have the supply byproduct at the national level or at the EU level. And also, all those regional models at NAT2 level are calibrated to the observed or projected values for a chosen simulation year. You probably remember that Capri is a comparative static model, meaning it provides results for a given year. Usually, I mean, we are going to present results for the medium term, meaning right now 2030, let's say, and also other simulation years are possible as well. So about the structure of the model. Well, in this slide, what you see is a schema of the structure of a supply model. I mean, this is just an example to, to remember, that these are optimization models under constraints. In columns, you see the decision variables. In this case, you see some crop activity levels measured most probably in hectares, and there you can see wheat, barley, potato, etc. And in rows, we have the equations. The first equation is the objective function, where we maximize profit measured as the sum over the over the crops of the gross value added, yeah, times the number of hectares per crop. And the following equations are the constraints that need to be respected. And there we can find resource constraints such as land and labor in this example, or other agronomic market or institutional constraints. So the schema illustrates this, the programming approach. I mean, this example is a linear model, but I mean, actually the supply models in Capri are non-linear models, as you will see later. So let's look now at the these supply models. We have seen that each supply model in Capri is an optimization model that maximizes regional profit subject to constraints and assuming exogenous prices. Let's have a closer look at the components of each of those regional models. First, let's look at the objective function. The objective function is to maximize the regional profit. The regional profit is defined as the total gross value added from agricultural production plus subsidies and minus the PMP terms that, I mean, let's call them for now calibration terms, and you will learn about these later on. These terms are used to calibrate the models, and well, we call them PMP because of the approach, positive mathematical programming that we use. So this is the objective function. And the components of this objective function is on the one hand this gross value added. This is gross value added from agricultural production. This is defined as revenues minus variable cost. This means that revenues come from sales of primary products such as cereals or oilseeds, fruits, etc., and also livestock products. So revenues from sales of production, of primary production. And then variable cost include purchase inputs such as fertilizers, seeds, or plant protection products, and also well young animals and feed concentrates. So this is about the gross value added, and then we said that in our profit we also need to account for subsidies. Well, in Capri, subsidies are modeled in great detail. Capri accounts for the current agricultural policy setting, and this means that we model the payments under the current CAP 2014-2020, and we do that in great detail and at the regional level. We account both for couple and decouple payments, as you see in the slide. I mean, about couple payments, you know that these couple payments may differ at the national or even at the regional level. And well, in Capri, I mean, we represent those payments at the regional level. And actually, the optimization approach user provides this flexibility to do that. So we model couple payments under the first pillar of the Common Agricultural Policy, such as voluntary couple support. And also we model some payments that are linked to land under the second pillar. And there you, in the slide, you have the main ones that are agri-environmental payments, the Natura 2000, and the least favored areas payment. We also account for payment ceilings in Capri, and if one of those ceilings is overshoot, then the payment is cut to fit the ceiling. So this is about a couple payment, and also we take into account the couple payments at the regional level. And well, in the current Common Agricultural Policy, mainly we account for this basic payment scheme and also for the greening requirements, yeah, that are represented to match the current implementation of the Common Agricultural Policy in each member state and also NATS 2 region. So we represent the Common Agricultural Policy in a great detail because, as you know, the Capri model is widely used to model impacts of measures of the Common Agricultural Policy. And to comment a bit on the last term of the objective function is this PMP terms that are added to calibrate the model to observe or projected data for the simulation year. I'm not going to comment on this right now because the calibration process will be explained in a later section. So let's go now to, okay, I cannot see, no problem. Let's go now to the, we have seen about the objective function, and let's comment now on the constraints. The constraints, we account for a lot of different constraints in Capri, that, and this can be, I mean, agrotechnical constraints, can be agronomical constraints, can be institutional constraints. So let's comment on some of those. First, I mean, fertilizers. Well, we have, we consider or incorporate a lot of details on fertilizer use and effects on the environment. And this is in this fertilizer balance or fertilizer module in Capri. So we model the balance between nutrient supply and nutrient removal. And this is done in great detail, as I said. Well, and in Capri, fertilizers are available from different sources, mainly from purchased mineral fertilizer, animal manure, and crop residues. And this fertilizer module also accounts for nutrient surplus and effects on the environment. So this is about fertilizer. That is one important module. Another important one is the feed module. This module guarantees that animal requirements of energy, protein, or dry matter are met from the various feeding sources that are available, and these are mainly from regional fodder or purchase feed or feed concentrates. So this is also another important module about feed, and then we have the institutional constraints that are needed to represent conditionality of CIP measures. We have seen that in the objective function we account for subsidies, and for these, because some of the CIP payments are linked to conditions that need to be respected, we need to add constraints. For instance, well, you all know that to receive greening payments, farmers have to comply with greening obligations, meaning crop and diversity, or the share of grassland, or the ecological focus area. So these are modeled in Capri also through constraints to link the payments to the respect of the corresponding constraint. And the last group of constraints, there are some more, we are just focusing at the most important modules in Capri, and the last one is the land balance. The land balance plays, of course, a central role in the Capri supply module. The shadow price for land is a cost in all crop activities, including fodder activities. So there's also a link to livestock through this land balance. And we have a land use module in Capri that is a very detailed one, and that it has, evolved through time, and now it's quite complex. What you can see in the slide, and maybe is the main issue to comment here, because I'm not going to comment in all the details, is that this land use module in Capri allows for imperfect substitution between arable land and grassland that is going to depend on the returns of these two types of agricultural land uses. So this is something also quite relevant. So once that we had a look at the objective function and the constraints in the supply module, we can have a look at how the supply model looks like. So we are just comment some details on the coding, how this is implemented in GAMS code. First, we have the main decision variables that are shown in the slide that are defined in a file that is called supply_model.gms. And I think there you have a bit more of detail on that. And the main variables, of course, there's a lot of variables in Capri, but we cannot comment on everything simultaneously. We need just to provide you some overview. So the main variables are going to be the objective variable, of course, and then the variable called v_at_level. That is for the level of production activities, meaning the hectares of land or heads for livestock activities. Then you have also some variables for selling and buying activities, or variables for feeding, or for fertilizers. So these are some of the main variables that can be considered. And the supply model requires a lot of data, and important parameters for this module are prices for all products. Remember, these are exogenous in this supply module. Also crop yields, for instance, or feed requirements for livestock, nutrient requirements for crops, etc. There's a lot of parameters, a lot of data that are needed, and most of these parameters are included in this data cube that is called Data in Capri, and contains a lot of information. Yeah, and eases the flow of information across steps in the supply module, not only in the supply but also in the in the, let's say, whole Capri model implementation. So most probably you already have had a look at this, or you will do in some exercises. I mean, there's a parameter called data with four dimensions. The first one for the region, the second one for the variable, the third for the product, and the last one for the year. And a lot of important data is included here in this parameter. Yeah. Okay. So if we have a look, most probably you already have seen also this this slide about the technical implementation of the Capri model. In this. This is what this schema shows, is the structure of the Capri code, where we start, I mean, reading the sets of Capri. You remember, I mean, Alice has just commented on the GAMS code, telling that there's only a few, I mean, elements, sets, variables, parameters, etc. So, I mean, here we start reading that, and the policy conditions, etc. And if we focus at the supply model, then there's two important files to look at, and these are highlighted in red in this slide. And these are the first one is the call supply underscore model, GMS, and the second one is called simu underscore supply GMS. In the first one, supply model is where the model is defined, meaning where the main variables and equations of the model are written. Yeah, and the second one is where the model is initialized and is called to be solved. So these are two important files to look at in this supply module. So this slide is showing the first of the files, the supply underscore model. And in this file, as I said, I mean, we are going to define the main variables of the model. We have already commented on the objective variable, the activity levels, selling and buying activities. And of course, there's much more than that. And then we are going to define the equations. This is, of course, all coded in GAMS. So first we name the equations, and then we are going to write each of those, yeah, the mathematical formulation of each of those equations. And later in this file, we are going to define the models. And there, I mean, you are going to see one definition that is M underscore cap mod, that is the linear part, or the linear model without the PMP terms, yeah. And then you are going to see the definition of the model that is used to solve the supply models, that is M underscore cap mod Q. And this includes the PMP terms. I guess you are going to look more in detail at the difference between the two model definition when you are going to learn about the PMP calibration. Yeah. So I mean, just for you to know that, I mean, if you are interested at looking at the equations for the supply model, you have to look at this equation, at this file, yeah, supply underscore model, yeah. And the second one I said is where we are going to initialize the model, provide the data and the starting values, and then we are going to solve it. Well, in this, well, this is what is done in the first line, is provide the starting values. Then we are going to set the model to solve that, as you can see, is M cap mod Q, meaning the nonlinear one. And then we are going to solve the model using a loop in GAMS, or meaning we are going to solve for each nuts to region independently. Remember, these are independent models. We are going to solve all together, but I mean, each of the models is independent, and that's why we use this this loop that allows for a parallel a solving of the models. Yeah. So this is what we are doing here. Yeah. And we use the command in GAMS solve to solve the model, and if we don't find an optimal solution or there are some problems with bounds or etc., we can't do something else afterwards with these widened bounds to try to avoid any infeasibilities or problems with bounds in our model. But I mean, that's most probably not necessary in this overview of the supply model to look at. I mean, the idea is in this file, simu underscore supply is where we are going to provide initial values for the model, and we are going to solve for each regions using this loop. And of course, once the model is solved, we are going to collect results, and we are going to sum up to get the production at the member state level or at the European level. So I think this is what I wanted to comment on as an overview of the supply model in Capri. Thank you very much for being there and for listening. And of course, I mean, if there's some questions, maybe this is the moment to comment on those.